What I hate even more is I'm thinking about betting him 450. Welcome back to another week of Stacking Dennys. I'm Jordan McAbee of FantasyRacingOnline.com. My co-host Nick Giffen of the Action Network. We just got done with Pocono, and it was Denny Hamlin in victory lane. And then he failed inspection, and Kyle Busch failed inspection as well. The win goes to Chase Elliott because he didn't fail inspection because they didn't – well, he technically passed inspection, but to be fair, when this happens – and there are and the top two cars fail inspection. They don't actually check the third place car as thoroughly as they do the first two. So he could have failed as well. And I think this is creating chaos for DFS players, for bettors especially, because the DFS world, DraftKings does not take into account the post race inspection failures and does not move drivers Kyle Busch, Denny Hamlin to the back like FanDuel does. FanDuel takes it into account. So if you were doing well in FanDuel with Kyle Busch, Denny Hamlin, you did not end up doing well on Sunday. Now, when it comes to betting, this is a whole nother thing. We haven't really seen this too often. Like, we haven't had many post-race inspection failures. I think you said we had like five, maybe four.
Yeah, none in cup as far as the winner.
Yeah, so and books don't have very good rules on these. Some of them do. Circa does. Circa has a really clear rule, but a lot of these books, they just don't. They haven't really accounted for this because it hasn't came up. But DraftKings has began as the best payout as far as this. They paid out Hamlin bets and Chase Elliott bets. Caesars ended up paying out Chase Elliott bets, and everyone else pretty much paid Hamlin bets. FanDuel came by, and I think it was yesterday they said that if you bet Elliott, they were going to give you site credit. So you're not going to get the cash, but you're going to get site credit. So it's better than nothing. It's definitely better than nothing. But definitely, I think that was, including all the drama and everything that happened, that was the best Pocono race I've seen in a while. And I'm kind of on your side, Nick, now of I like Pocono. From what I saw on Sunday, that was a good race. That was good racing, and it was a good race. Once again, Kyle Busch had the best car. I don't know how he is so good at these large flat tracks, but he is, when they raced at Big Indy and then at Pocono, he's always up front. It doesn't matter the car. It doesn't matter anything. He's always dominant. He led the most laps again. Couldn't get past Denny Hamlin there at the end. He said his car was too tight, but that was a very good race. Do you agree? And what are your overall thoughts there on you know, Hamlin and Kyle Busch failing inspection? Another Gibbs car failing inspection seems to happen a lot.
Yeah. First of all, yes, it was a good race. I enjoyed the hell out of it. And you know, I already like Pocono, and that was a great Pocono race. It had a little bit of everything. You know, there was the question of would Hamlin make it on fuel? And then that kind of went away with the caution stuff. So it had a little bit of potential strategy. And it did have a strategy. We saw multiple different strategies. We saw Bubba Wallace take a different strategy. We saw Eric Jones on a different strategy. Of course, I had outrights on both of them. So I was like, sweet. I have like two of the guys that are potentially leading on their own strategies. And I had Chastain who was running up front on the main strategy. So I had potentially the leader. And at certain points, Chastain was leading the leader on three different strategies. I was feeling great. And it all fell apart, of course, as far as betting for me. And that's okay. It happens. I hit both my head-to-head matchups. Got refunded on Eric Jones. I shouldn't say refunded, but, you know, site credit or whatever it is on Eric Jones' top 10. So that's good. Yeah, it was very wild a race. And as far as the betting stuff goes, there are books that had very clear rules. Like you mentioned, Circa pays out post-inspections. They paid out Elliott, and it was very clear. And all bets at Circa, NASCAR bets, are paid out post-inspection. BetMGM was actually very clear as well, but they screwed up their own payouts, which was a mess. They paid out the wrong one, contradictory to their actual very clear rules. They should have paid out Hamlin per their rules, and they paid out Elliott, and then they ended up paying out Hamlin again, and it was a whole mess. And DraftKings had very clear rules that they pay out both sets of results, essentially. So then there was books, like, amazingly enough, the biggest sports book in the industry, the Westgate Superbook in Nevada, has three different sets of rules depending on if you use their app, their website, or you take the sheet from the kiosk essentially at the casino book, at the gate there or whatever, the counter. The betting sheets that you get in the sports book. So three different sets of rules at the Westgate. What the hell? Like, what are you even supposed to do? Other sites just had totally unclear rules. I know Boyd Gaming in Nevada, totally contradictory rules to themselves. So you could argue they should have paid out either one. So just an absolute total mess. And books need to rewrite their rules so it's explicitly clear, not for motorsports, but for NASCAR specifically, and IndyCar specifically if you offer IndyCar, and F1 specifically if you offer F1, because a lot of them have rules written up for Formula One, podium presentation. Well, NASCAR doesn't do a podium presentation, right? Like, so what does that even mean? And then official results. Well, the official results are the post-inspection one, but they say official results when the race is over. Well, that's actually unofficial, so you're contradicting yourself. Y'all need to get the lingo straight and come up with some clear, well-defined rules like Circa has. Circa has the clearest, best set of rules. DraftKings does as well. Very good. BetMGM has clear rules, even though they are a little hard to understand. They make sense. But, I don't care which option you take. If you pay out the Hamlin option, or if you pay out the Elliott option, or if you pay out both, I don't care which option the book does. That's up to us as the bettors what we want to do. But your rule needs to be clear. Rules need to be clear. And that's the big takeaway from this whole schmozzle. It's not a good deal here. As far as the inspection failures themselves, you're right. It's possible Chase Elliott could have failed if they'd torn his car down more. They take the top five cars. The two they really tear down are first and second. And then they also take two cars back to the R&D center. We find out today one of those two cars failed post-race inspection as well. So three of the four cars they actually seriously looked at failed inspection. So if they had seriously looked at Chase Elliott's car, who knows? I mean, of course, he's in a Chevy, different team, Hendrick Motorsports, but McDowell and a Ford, and those two Toyotas failed. Very curious what would have happened if they had torn down Chase Elliott's car.
And I was a couple things. One, Christopher Bell was up there. He finished sixth, got bumped up to fourth after the inspection failures. But if he was running third, they wouldn't have tore his car down. And you have to think that all the Gibbs cars were illegal. Like, both Hamlin and Kyle Busch had the extra tape underneath the wrap.
I actually think Truex was probably not illegal. A, he was the slowest, but B, if he won, he couldn't afford to have that win taken away, right? And lose 100 points and potentially fall out of the points. So my guess is Truex probably didn't have that. But I think you're right. I'm sure Christopher Bell did. I know, obviously, Denny Hamlin and Kyle Busch did.
So are you on board with saying that this was an absolute deliberate attempt to cheat by Joe Gibbs Racing?
I believe so. I don't necessarily believe their statement that we had a process and we accidentally messed it up kind of thing. I think they were seeing what they could get away with. Kind of just see what they think they could get away with during this part. And I think they probably looked at the rules and saw this wasn't going to be a significant enough infraction to negatively impact their post-race their playoff chances, that it was worth the risk. Especially with Hamlin, who has two wins and is way down there in the points anyway. Kyle Busch with a win, Christopher Bell with a win. And so I guess Bell's a little iffy because he has one win, and a 100-point loss for him would hurt him and maybe put him behind, right around Kurt Busch. I don't know the exact standings right now. But if we take away Christopher Bell's, whatever points he got this race, let's say 40-something ballpark, then that would be at like 540. And then you take 100 away from that, that's like 440. Yeah, he's below Kurt Busch. So potentially, or 560, but yeah, 460, he'd still be below Kurt Busch. So they may not have done it with Bell either, but absolutely they had nothing to lose with Kyle Busch and with Denny Hamlin. So it's hard to say whether they did it with Truex, hard to say whether they did it with Bell, but I do believe, my personal opinion, just an opinion, but I believe it was intentional. The other thing that's weird is NASCAR said it was like extra vinyl in the interview. They said it was like extra vinyl, and JGR said it was a piece of tape. So there's a little bit of contradictory information there as well, but who knows?
Mm-hmm. So you mentioned before, you know, another guy that got popped today, news broke today, Michael McDowell, his car, they modified a part. He got a full L2 penalty, 100 driver points, 100 owner points, crew chief suspended for 4 races, $100,000 in fines. Joe Gibbs Racing did not get anything except for the disqualification. Should they have gotten more than that? I think that's like the newest controversy today. You know, did Joe Gibbs Racing deserve to be penalized actual points for what seems like deliberate cheating and winning the race?
Yeah, it's interesting because NASCAR has three things they don't want you to mess with. The fuel, jet fuel, right? Michael Waltrip.
Mm-hmm.
The engine, Carl Long, oversized engine, if we remember that penalty, and aero. And this modified the aero. So the way it worked, and based off of Bozzy Tatarevich thread on Twitter, plus what I understand from NASCAR and the tape deal, basically the vinyl covers, the wrap, the vinyl, it covers the car. And underneath that wrap, there's little like grooves in the kind of the nose area. And those grooves create turbulence, right? You want everything to be smooth. So those grooves underneath the wrap create turbulence. And one little piece of tape, even if it smooths it out just a little bit, will reduce that turbulence, change that airflow, and help. So very interesting. So, you know, that's why NASCAR didn't catch it pre-race, because they had to pull the wrap up. And then they found that extra tape. So I don't think it was we accidentally left tape in this perfectly aerodynamic spot. You know, I think it's pretty intentional. There's no reason to put tape there underneath wrap ever. Like, there's no process for that ever. Like that. So I think maybe they should have. At the same time, NASCAR themselves didn't feel as egregious enough. It was a small, relatively small piece of tape. I guess it was in Denny Hamlin's trophy's mouth in his little video there. But, I maybe would have liked to seen something a little more. Obviously, maybe not on the L2 level, but potentially L1 level and dock view, playoff points, et cetera, because we don't want teams doing that. We don't want them – even if it's an accident, you need to, I think, police that a little bit harder so teams – take it more seriously and don't have those accidents. But
I feel like there's just a very stark difference between that type of cheating and like the stuff that McDowell's getting popped for, the stuff that Keselowski got popped for. Like, it's so that range is so wide of what the actual punishment is. Like, I feel like there should be something in between, because
an L1's right in between, and for whatever reason they didn't go with the L1. McDowell got that full L2, and to be fair, McDowell did race with that car, and he finished what, like, sixth place after the Hamlin and the mm-hmm. Kyle Busch DQs. I think it was eighth mm-hmm. place before that and sixth after, something like that. So he had a strong day. We knew he was gonna be good at Pocono, and he was, but he also had the benefit of some things going on with his car. So I would love to have seen Hamlin and Kyle Busch. They got the DQ. So, I mean, that's kind of the points dock for them, right? They lost 40, 50, 60 points.
40, yeah.
So yeah. That may be why they didn't enforce an L1 penalty, simply because they already lost the points. I think if they had found it kind of like they did here, the teardown, they probably would have L1'd them. So maybe it makes sense.
Yeah, and I'm trying to find your tweet, because you were talking about how many times – Joe Gibbs Racing has been.
Oh yeah, yeah. So of the four times that the winner has been disqualified, it's happened once in trucks, and that was Ross Chastain in trucks. It's happened twice in Xfinity where the winner's been disqualified. Both of those were Joe Gibbs Racing cars. I think one was Kyle Busch and one was Denny Hamlin. And now it's happened in Cup one time, but sort of twice, right? Like, Denny Hamlin got disqualified, so Kyle Busch would have been the winner, but he got disqualified. So four of the five would-be winners were Joe Gibbs Racing DQs in the era of these new disqualification penalties that will prevent you from winning even if you cross the finish line first, which started in 2019. So we've had four instances in 4 years, but kind of like five instances in 4 years if you count Kyle Busch as well.
Mm-hmm. And the only other time I can remember a post-race failure inspection, I think it was Jimmy Johnson. He finished second and got DQ'd.
We've had a few. We've had a few throughout the years.
I'm forgetting a couple. I'm probably
even in Cup. I think Chase Elliott had one last year. Yeah, he had one at Nashville. Chris Buescher had one at Daytona number two last year. And let's see, 2020, I'm going through. We had the Jimmy Johnson one, which kept him out of the playoffs. That and COVID kept him out of the playoffs. And Eric Jones got disqualified in 2019 at Richmond 2. So we've had a few instances in Cup, but this is the first time it's been a winner.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it seems like, you know, JGR definitely has a tendency to fail post-race inspection, whereas I feel like Hendrick is most likely to fail pre-race inspection, at least the last couple years. You know, Chase Elliott and Kyle Larson last year happened quite a few times. But looking at the actual point standings, I mean, Chase Elliott's up to 25 playoff points now. He's pretty much got this regular season title wrapped up. It's going to take a major, major just complete
meltdown. Not
failure. But meltdown, there we go. Wow. Meltdown for him to lose this, especially we're heading to Indy Road Course. We know how good he is on road courses. Like, he's the favorite to win again. According to the books, he could easily get another win. But looking at 25 playoff points, 105 points ahead of Ross Chastain in second in points. Ross kept the
Do you want to talk about that Ross Chastain incident?
That's exactly where I was getting to. Exactly where I was getting to. You read my mind. So, yeah, a little bit of which I was very thankful for, because DFS-wise, I
was not thankful.
Hey, at least one of us benefited. But
that's true.
When I was making my lineups race day, I was just looking at how lineup construction was going, and I really wanted to be heavy on Christopher Bell. I really wanted to be heavy on Reddick. And in order for me to do that, I was trying you know, Ross Chastain was the chalk. So what I did was looked at the price, and I'm like, I can come down off of Chastain and fit the guys that I want to and still get some place differential plays in there. Which is exactly what I did. So I stayed away from Chastain. I stayed away from Harvick, which that wreck was just absolutely perfect for me in all DFS. And I know you're sitting here shaking your head. Like, it was
and
so
Reddick
bad.
Was terrible all day. Like, he was running in teens all I know, day.
I know.
And Chastain was kicking ass all day. My bets were looking amazing all day. And somehow you benefit. God, what the? No. But the funny thing is, you can't say that either of those strategies, my bets or your DFSs, were bad plays. Sometimes they go hand in hand with their, like we've talked about this many times, it's a natural hedge. Did you bet Ross outright to win as well?
I bet Chase, like, right before green flag, I bet Chase 7-1. Mm-hmm. I was about to bet Ross live, literally. When they were going into that corner, I was trying to get it in because he was plus 345 or something.
Yeah,
and I'm like, I was like, I cannot pass this up. And as I'm like sitting there trying to get it in, he hits the wall, and I'm like, thank God I was not able to get this bet in. That's the luckiest I've ever been on a line.
That ruins potentially so many things for me. Luckily, I still end up winning my two head-to-heads. But I was leading the head-to-heads at the time. I had Ross outright. Had Eric Jones well inside the top 10 with an outside shot to win. Mm-hmm. And it all just fell to hell. I may have lost. I think I may have lost. Well, so I didn't end up betting any top manufacturer bets this past weekend, but I put in my Action Network Slack that I liked Christopher Bell at 7-1 at DraftKings. And had I actually bet that, Christopher Bell would have finished as a top Toyota after the DQs, and I think DraftKings would have paid that out because they paid out both sets of stuff, I believe. So kind of bummed I didn't end up betting that. But I thought Christopher Bell 7-1 top Toyota was a pretty good bet. But Yeah, that kind of screwed my day, but it made your day really fucking awesome, which is great. So, what we've talked about it before, you can naturally hedge in DFS. Like, I can like Ross Chastain outright while still thinking he can be overplayed in DFS.
Yeah.
And that makes sense. So, like, both can be positive EV and a natural hedge, which we talk about hedging. The only time you should hedge, in my opinion, is if it's a positive EV bet. Well, we're not making a bet here. We're doing DFS, which, I mean, I guess is kind of betting. But we're essentially saying we're going underweight on Ross because the field's going to be overweight. Or we could go GTO on Ross and we'll still be under compared to the field. So if optimal for Ross is 50%, the field's 60%, we play 50%, we're still getting that leverage on the field. We're just going optimal on Ross. It's still plus EV play to be under on Ross and then bet him to win because – let's face it, he shouldn't have been 15-1 to win. He kicked ass. Yeah. He kicked ass, and 15-1 was absurd. So PJ wrote that up at Action Network, and 100% I agreed with him. I think I bet it the night before, and it didn't move overnight, so he wrote it up quick in the morning. I wrote up two head-to-head bets. They both ended up hitting, so at least the Action Network write-ups were good. Just didn't end up having a positive day because I didn't hit an outright, and I didn't have enough other bets to cover outrights. You know, my two head-to-heads won, my Eric Jones won, but it just wasn't enough to cover how much I had on outrights. And that's because I felt really strong about my outrights. I really felt strong about Eric Jones. I really felt strong about Bubba Wallace. I really felt strong about Ross Chastain. At the time, I thought Blaney at 14-1 was good, but that ended up being a shit show. And I think those were my four outright bets. I don't know if I had any others, but I can't remember if I did. But either way, it's all tracked in the app, and unfortunately just didn't work out for me.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, going back to the Chastain incident, you know, the first thing that's flying all over Twitter when that happens is it payback? You know, did Hamlin just get Ross Chastain back? And no, there's no way you can possibly look at that and say that was payback by Denny Hamlin. What that is how people are going to race Ross Chastain from now on, because he's an aggressive driver, and people know that, and they're not going to give him an inch of room. So they're not going to intentionally put him in the wall, at least not right now. I still think that payback's coming later this year in the playoffs, but right now, and like, you know, last week at Pocono, all Hamlin did was just not give him room.
Yeah.
That's all that Denny Hamlin did. And I don't like, you know, the first thing they did when they interviewed Denny Hamlin after the race, you know, right there on the racetrack was that payback? Was that intent? Like, one, he's not going to say it. And two, why are you trying to create a story there? Because it's like, just use your brain. Like, I don't like that. I don't like that at all, but I don't see how people could even see that was, or that could have been, you know, Hamlin.
They have to, though. I mean, like, the media has to, right? They have to question that because it was an incident but involving Chastain where Hamlin was right next to him. So they have to ask, did you intentionally, even though you didn't touch him, did you intentionally run him out of room? That kind of stuff and whatever. But you're right. All it was hard racing. Ross Chastain wrecked himself. He could have backed out of it. He could have, honestly, he could have come down into Hamlin and kept himself off the wall, but he decided not to. I think for obvious reasons, he didn't want to three times Denny Hamlin there. So I actually thought Ross was being kind of respectful to Hamlin and that he didn't come down off the wall to try to, you know, fight for that. I don't think Denny would have appreciated that. So Ross just wrecked himself. That's not payback by Denny Hamlin. Anybody says it was, anybody says he got his payback, wrong. Denny just raced him hard. Ross wrecked himself. And I think Ross knows that because you heard his interview. He still thinks he has it coming. He's like, I don't, you know, that was like Denny not giving me but I still think maybe I have more coming. He even said that. And I think he knows Denny didn't touch him. Denny didn't race him. I wouldn't say dirty. He just raced him hard and didn't give him room. But that's what Ross has done all year. Ross hit Denny from behind at Gateway. Straight up just from behind, dumped him. Oh, Ross, you know, races hard, and I respect this kind of racing. He just dumped him. I can't respect a guy dumping a guy, right? Like when Joey Logano dumped Kenseth, I didn't respect that. I was happy to see Kenseth pay back Logano. I also don't like Logano, but Ross deserves payback, and that was not payback. That was just hard racing between two drivers that are not exactly on the best of terms, but the payback itself is still coming. probably in the playoffs, maybe next year. Denny said Ross is not going to expect it, right? Mm. So we'll see. But again, the second time, Ross hit Denny in the left rear at Atlanta. We talked about Atlanta. He had two incidents, one with Truex, one with Denny. The Truex one was fine. He was straight up behind him, didn't touch him, just got the air off him. Plus, you also bump drafted Atlanta. But this, the Denny incident in Atlanta wasn't bump drafting. Him in the left rear spun him. So twice Ross has screwed up with Denny. And Denny has not touched Ross in payback, period.
Mm-hmm. We've talked about Chastain and how aggressive he is and how that can easily come back to hurt him in the playoffs. Do you think that I feel like he hasn't really learned anything through all of this. Like, there's still 20 laps to go when that happened. Why? Like, he took it. You said it. He took himself out. He took himself out from a potential race win. Like, what are you doing? You still haven't learned anything. And I, you know, we both have the Chastain championship bets. And I can't say that I'm overly confident that he's going. I think I made a good bet. Like, I think I got it at like 18. I know you got it, what, 40, 30?
50.
But,
yeah.
50, yeah.
And some people got it at 60. I got it at 50. Some people even got it at 60.
Yeah. It's not to say that, like, if you're going just off of speed, then yeah, Ross Chastain can legitimately win this championship. But everything else, it's going to take a little bit of luck for him to get in there, even if he makes the final race. Even if he makes it to Phoenix, because then, like, if he makes it to Phoenix and Hamlin hasn't gotten his payback, you have to believe it's coming that race. Something's going to happen.
Oh, 100%. But I will say,
if he gets to the final four,
if they both do get to the final four, let's say Hamlin doesn't, then the payback on Ross it's 100% going to happen. But if they're both in the final four together, Hamlin's payback is going to have to be so big that it puts Ross out of the race and doesn't give Ross a chance to Kenseth him, you know, in return. You know what I mean? Or it's going to have to come payback, so late in the race.
It had to be late, I think, because I think if he did something that deliberate, I think NASCAR would park him.
Denny Hamlin? Possibly. But yeah. Possibly not. I don't know. It's tough to say. The reason they parked Kenseth, because Kenseth was already like two laps or many laps down and straight up just punted Logano with a already wrecked race car. I don't think they'd park Denny Hamlin for just punting Ross Chastain, because Ross Chastain punted Denny Hamlin. They didn't park Ross Chastain. If Denny Hamlin had a wrecked car and was multiple laps down and did that, yeah, I think they would park him. But My point is, if they're both alive in the championship race and Denny does that, Denny's going to have to make sure. I actually don't think it can be too late, because if Denny ends up costing himself the championship lead there, he won't have enough time to get it back, potentially. So he's going to have to do it early enough in the race, in the championship race, that it happens and he can still recover or not lose the lead, or recover and get the lead if he does somehow lose it. But he also needs to make sure that it ends Ross's day and Ross cannot continue, because otherwise Ross will Kenseth him, potentially. It's going to be wild, but that's all for down the road. The payback has not happened yet. Anybody who says it has is wrong, period.
Yep. It's that's just going to be so fun just watching, you know, the rest of the season, just because. And who's to say Ross Chastain won't wreck somebody else by the time we do get around to the playoffs. But we're looking, we still have 14 winners. We now have 5 races left until the playoff cut line. With McDowell's penalty, that it doesn't hurt. It hurts a little bit for my goal of getting to 17, because if McDowell wins Daytona or something, he would need 2 wins basically to get into the playoffs. But that dream is still alive. Martin Truex Jr., Ryan Blaney are both in on points as of now. Truex has about a 80-something point lead over Kevin Harvick. So I think it's going to take a win for Kevin Harvick to get in. Same with Eric Almirola, Eric Jones, Austin Dillon. But not totally impossible. As far as the rest of the standings, though, you know, like I said, I think Chase Elliott has this thing locked up regular season. He's going to get those extra 15 points. He could easily he could easily start the playoffs with 50 points in each round, which would just be massive this year because, you know, the second highest right now is Ross Chastain with 14. Currently, I think it's only Bet Rivers that offers these, but to get into the final four of the championship, currently Chase Elliott is minus 155, which I think is fair. I don't know if I'd bet it. And then Ross Chastain is actually second highest at plus 115. I don't think I'd bet that. Just with everything going on with Chastain, I don't think there's enough value there for me to bet that.
Yeah, I agree with that. I don't think there is. You know, you're mentioning these playoff standings, and one little interesting, obviously Kurt Busch missed this past race weekend, which drops him to the lowest driver with a win, with one win. Obviously Denny has two in the points, but right in front of him, 2 points in front of him is Chase Briscoe. Another 8 points in front of that, Austin Cindric. Another 14 points in front of that, Tyler Reddick. So those four drivers all have one win, and they're all right next to each other in the point standings. If we get 217 winners, one of those drivers, if they don't get a second win, is probably going to be out. There's a potential it could be Daniel Suarez or Alex Bowman as well, who are a little bit further ahead. You know, Suarez is 17 points ahead of Reddick, and Bowman's 10 points ahead of Suarez. So between Kurt Busch and Alex Bowman, there's a 51-point gap. Theoretically, Alex Bowman can lose 51 points to the whole field in five races if he has, you know, three bad races. And Daytona, anybody could have a bad race.
Right.
And, you know, I mean, Bowman's already had four DNFs this year, plus a couple other bad finishes the first two races of the year, 24th and 25th at Daytona and Auto Club to start the year. So he's had six bad finishes already this year, and that's in 21 races. So we're talking like between one third and one quarter of the time, Alex Bowman has had a bad race, but he's had a streak there where he had three bad races out of four, three DNFs in four races between Nashville and New Hampshire. If that happens again, he might be on the outside looking in as the one win driver. So I don't think he's safe. And the reason we bring this up, the bottom portion of this one win standings is because if they're knocked out, obviously they don't make the playoffs. So that affects what they do this weekend at Indy. Especially Kurt Busch, especially Chase Briscoe, especially Austin Cindric. And we saw this with Chase Briscoe and Austin Cindric at the most recent road course race at Road America, that they each stayed out in one of the stages and never recovered far enough. Austin Cindric recovered to 7th. Chase Briscoe recovered to 14th, despite winning stage one. So they just didn't recover enough to win, and I don't think you can bet Kurt Busch to win. I don't think you can bet Chase Briscoe to win. I don't think you can bet Austin Cindric to win. I don't think you can bet Tyler Reddick, last road course winner, to win this week. Especially those four, I don't think you can bet to win. I think there's a little more argument for Daniel Suarez, a little more argument from Alex Bowman, but even then, I think I'm probably waiting till live odds on those two. So it's just, here's like let's look at Tyler Reddick, for example. He was 25-1 at win at Road America, and he had to win. He won. Now he's what, 12-1, I think, at 10. DraftKings. 10-1 now. He was 12 earlier.
Yeah. Opened at 12.
Now he's, you can find him 11-1 at points bet. So let's say 11-1. His odds literally went from 25-1 to now 11-1 at the next road course race. And there's a much higher probability he doesn't even go for the winning strategy. How can you bet that? Like, if you're on the fence about betting Tyler Reddick 25-1 at Road America, how can you feel good about betting him 12-1 when he's got a very good chance of points racing? It doesn't make sense to me. Right? Like, Tyler Reddick all season long has been 18-25 at road courses. Now he's the shortest he's ever been, and this is the first time he'll actually probably be points racing, or at least have a very good chance of points racing, to preserve, you know, being on the good side of the 17 winners. And now people are willing to bet him? I don't get it. I just do not get it, and it doesn't make sense to me. And I know we're talking about the standings and the playoffs and all this stuff, but like, because, you know, you did mention Cindric and those guys down there, I was like, this just feels like a good point to make. I just don't feel comfortable betting Kurt Busch, Chase Briscoe, Austin Cindric, or Tyler Reddick outright this week. Maybe they do end up going on the winning strategy, maybe, but I'm not willing to bet them. I think the longest of any of those is like 18-1. Austin Cindric, longest you can get is 14-1 right now. Chase Briscoe, longest you can get is 16-1 right now.
Yeah.
And I mean, obviously Kurt Busch, but I think Kurt Busch and Toyota have been so bad that it doesn't make sense that his odds would be in the teens. But you know, we will talk about Toyota in a little bit, cause I have some things to say about Toyota. We know how bad they've been at road courses this year, but I don't think you can bet Kurt Busch. So of those four, I just don't see any way to bet any of them outright.
Honestly, I don't see value. I don't know about you, but as far as an outright winner, I don't see any value anywhere on this betting board.
I haven't made a single outright. Yeah.
I see nothing that I like. I agree. You know, Allmendinger at 20 kind of piques my interest, but not enough for me to jump on it. I would like Bell at 22-1, but with Toyota struggles this year, I can't get over that. Like you said, we're going to talk about that in a little bit. But everything else, like, we know who's – and we talked about this a couple weeks ago with the last road course race, which was Sonoma or no.
Road America.
We know who's fast on road courses this year, and it's not going to change. This new car, we know who's fast. And we've had different winners. We've had three different winners in road courses, but every single person has pretty much been fast at all of them. Chase Elliott's been up there. Ross Chastain's always fast. Reddick is fast. Suarez, Cindric, Briscoe, you know, depending on what they do. But yeah, so, you know, going back to Tyler Reddick, I understand, like, wanting to root for the guy and wanting him to win, and he's coming off, you know, the win at the last road course. But yeah, he's going to qualify well because he always qualifies well at road courses. Like, you can pretty much guarantee he's going to make the final round of qualifying, which is only going to increase, I believe, the probability that he's going to be points racing, mm-hmm. because he's going to have the clear opportunity to get the 10 stage points, because someone like a Chase Elliott or a Ross Chastain, if they're up there running, they're going to pit. And then, you know, if Reddick's running third, he's going to just stay out and get those 10 points and get the playoff point.
Absolutely.
And go from there. And it's every single race this year, we've seen it not work out every single time. So the strategy makes sense depending on what position you're in. But yes, as bettors, like I have no, and you couldn't say enough. Nobody could convince me to bet Tyler Reddick at 10-1. Because what's going to happen is he's probably going to run that strategy, and then in the middle of the race, he's going to be 25-1 live.
And here's the thing, and I don't mean this in a bragging way or a putting anybody down way. Remember when we talked on Stacking Dennys for Road America, and I picked Tyler Reddick 25-1 to win, and you're like, wow. And mm-hmm. I convinced people to bet Tyler Reddick at 25-1. People weren't on him necessarily at Road America, but I knew that this was the perfect track for him. 25-1 was too long. Look, I'm not on him at 12-1. I think he's a good road course racer, but I'm not on him 12-1, even if he was on the winning strategy. Now, give a very good chance of him not being on the winning strategy, and I think it's just a terrible bet. So here's the other thing. You know, all these guys suddenly get, let's say, taken out of contention. Tyler Reddick, Austin Cindric, yada, yada. Let's hypothetically say those four guys or six guys I mentioned, Kurt Busch all the way up through Alex Bowman, they points race. Well, what have we seen this year with drivers that stay out, and you mentioned this, stay out for at least one of the stages and pit during the stage caution? Well, we've seen this happen, and I put numbers to this on Twitter. I tweeted this out. Don't know if you saw, but tweeted this out. There have been 49 times where a driver has stayed out in either stage one or stage two or both in the three road course races this year. So 49 different drivers in the three races. Twice has a driver finished inside the top five out of those 49. The two times, were both at COTA, where 27 drivers stayed out in one or the other stage, mm-hmm. right? So that's way more than half the field, which gives us a lot of opportunity. And still only two of those 27 finished inside the top five. One of them was Chase Elliott. One of them was Chase Elliott, and he finished fourth. But he would not have finished inside the top five had A.J. Allmendinger not wrecked there at the end and Chase Briscoe not wrecked there at the end, right? And neither A.J. Allmendinger or Chase Briscoe stayed out in stage one or stage two. They were actually doing the optimal strategy. So Elliott would have been sixth and not even finished inside the top five had those two not had problems. We'd be looking at one out of 49. Plus, Chase Elliott isn't sitting here like 12 to 1 or 18 to 1. He's sitting here 5 to 1. We expect this guy to be finishing towards the front and have a chance to on this kind of strategy. And he still only would have gotten up to sixth, maybe. The other one was Alex Bowman. He finished second, but it still took some wild circumstances for him to get there. We had a lot of late restarts at COTA. Multiple late restarts. So
don't remind me.
Yeah, exactly. Well, I love Daniel. I guess we were flipping on that one, but versus Pocono. But at Sonoma, 10 drivers stayed out in stage one, and those same drivers of those 10, a few stayed out in stage two. So only 10 unique drivers stayed out either in stage one or stage two. Best any of those finished was 12th. And at Road America, 12 drivers stayed out in either stage one, two, or both. And the best any of them finished was Austin Cindric in 7th. So I don't see how you can think any of these guys will finish inside the top five. And if they do, it's been 2 out of 49. And yeah, some of them have been your Joey Hands or your Cody Wares. Let's say half of them are uncompetitive. That's still only 2 out of 50. So that's only 2 out of 25, which means 1 out of 12 and a half. To finish in the top five, not to win, 1 out of 12 and a half. So let's say 12 and a half to 1 odds, or 11 and a half to 1 odds, to finish in the top five. If you're getting a driver at 11 and a half to 1 to finish in the top five, he's probably, 40 or 50 to 1 to win the race? So these guys should not be in the teens. These Austin Cindrics, these Briscoes, these Daniel Suarez's, they should not be in the teens. These Tyler Reddicks, they should be in the 20s or 30s at fair value just because of the high probability of them staying out. And books are not taking in this account. And what happens is that actually does open up value. So even though I don't like betting Chase Elliott at 5 to 1 or 4.5 to 1, or like betting Kyle Larson at 6.5, or Ross Chastain at 6.5, 7.5, whatever it is, you can get the best odds now. One guy I think is interesting is AJ Allmendinger at 20 to 1. If all those other guys decide right there to with you. Do that, but Toyota 4.5 to 1 to win the race, and this is what I want to talk about.
Yes, because I'm. Yeah, I need to hear this because they've been so bad at road course. Like they haven't just been bad, like they've been bad. For Toyota, they've been bad. I really want to hear this, what you're thinking about Toyota, because there's been quite a few. I put in a few early week bets, and as have you. You put up an article today about a 250 to 1 long shot that quickly went down to 100 to 1, but go ahead. What you're thinking on Toyota this week? Because this is going to take some convincing for me, because I'm not there.
Right, and like I said, this is Toyota to win, and 4.5 to 1 means the implied probability is 18.2%. Toyota has to win 18.2% of the time, and if we lop off a good chunk of the field's probability to win, A, that helps, but B, and that's actually only a little part of my argument, Toyota made gains at Road America. If we look at their average green flag speed ranking, it was the best of the year at Road America. Now, here's the other thing. So funny enough, I removed major incidents. Funny enough, Bubba Wallace has DNF'd all three road course races, and all the other guys did not have major incidents. Maybe some minor ones, but no major incidents. So it's the same five drivers at all three road course races. So we can be like very fair about this. Well, we're discounting Kurt Busch anyway, and he's been the worst of them all at every single road course race. So we're discounting Kurt Busch anyway. We're basically just saying it's the JGR cars. You could maybe be like, well, Daniil Kyvat or whatever his name is from F1. He's in a shitbag, shitbox car. Come on.
Those now. Cars Come are on. So
Those
bad.
Those Hesseberg cars are beyond garbage. Yes, I know one's going to be a Ford and one's going to be a Toyota. Loris Hesseberg, Jacques Villeneuve, they've raced this year. Those cars are shit boxes.
Yes.
Like
worse than BJ McLeod's cars, and that's saying something.
Yes. So anyway, let's discount Kurt Busch. So if we remove Kurt Busch from this analysis, here's what we have. At COTA, the average green flag speed ranking was 17.75. At Sonoma, 18.25. So a little worse, about the same, you know. But at Road America, 15.5. And three of the four, only Kyle Busch, three of the four were between 11th and 16th, which is a marked improvement on where they were, having multiple drivers, you know, 17th or worse. So a notable improvement. But the other thing that I think is very important is Indy itself. And this is what I wanted to talk about. The three road course races we've had this year, COTA, built in 2010. That's when we say it's repaved, right? Because it was built in 2010 and hasn't been repaved since. Sonoma, repaved in 2005. Road America, repaved half a century ago. Indy, repaved less than a decade ago. So it is the newest repave. And where did JGR struggle? They struggled on the long runs at these road courses. They had short run speed. If we look at their practice times, they have short run speed. If we look at their race times, you can go to the NASCAR media, for those of us that are NASCAR media members, and look at their short run speed. It's much better than their long run speed. So I think lower tire wear will help them this weekend. So we take into account they've made gains at the road courses, plus one other factor. Between Sonoma and Elkhart Lake, it was like a one race gap. There was like Sonoma, another race, and then Road America. Well, they've had Elkhart Lake is Road America. For those of you, if I'm confusing terms there, it's like Sonoma, Infineon, Sears Point, all that. Like there's had multiple names in the past, and I still sometimes revert to default names. But Road America, Elkhart Lake, same track. They made gains there, but they didn't have much turnaround time between Sonoma and Elkhart Lake. Now they've had a lot of turnaround time between road courses, a lot of time to figure out what they've improved on, what made them better. And I think that extra time, the improvement they've already showed, the lower tire wear, and taking out a lot of these guys, and my model and Jim Sonnis' model showing 4.5-1 as value, even without taking these other things into account, right? Like, my model can't be like, well, Tyler Reddick's got to be a third of what he should be to win. It doesn't take any of that into account. Both my model and Jim Sonnis' model from Number Fire FanDuel show value Toyota 4.5-1. So I've got like five reasons that I want to bet them at 4.5-1.
You're convincing me. But not enough for me to bet it.
I didn't think I would. I'm cool with betting.
And I can't wait till next week where I'm like, should have fucking bet that.
I'm cool with betting Toyota. And then like seriously, let's look at the current odds. Toyota 4.5-1, Chase Elliott 4.5-1. Like if you bet Toyota, Chase Elliott, Kyle Larson, and Ross Chastain and size them all right, you can still make money if one of them wins. And Allmendinger. You can fit like the four most favorite in odds that are non-Toyotas and not counting the Reddicks, the Suarez's, the Bowmans. You can fit the four highest in odds, so Allmendinger, Chastain, Larson, Elliott, and Toyota, and size everything right to make money if any of that wins.
I hear you. It's definitely... I hate to say, like, because you can't really wait till after practice, because if Toyota comes out and they look good in practice, that 450 is going to be gone. Like, and that's kind of where, you know. But I think all your points are, like, I'll be honest, I don't plan on betting much at all this week. I'm not seeing enough value anywhere for me to make any bets outright right now. And so unless something drastically changes my mind in practice, I'm probably not going to even bet an outright winner. But all the points you made are excellent points to consider for DFS, because with this being the fourth road course race of the season, people are going to be off of Toyotas. Like, it's not, three races isn't just a blip. Like, that is a trend. And that's where that's the small little pivots that we talk about that you can make, to where if you can get, like, depending on where DraftKings comes out in prices, like Christopher Bell this week. Christopher Bell's a really good road course racer. If he comes in mid 8,000, you know, qualifies 12th, and he has this stigma of Toyotas suck, yeah, it's not going to be super comfortable to take him in DFS, but as far as strategy goes, that would end up being a very good pivot.
Yeah, and of the Toyotas this year, Martin Truex Jr.'s average green flag speed rank at the road courses is 15. Christopher Bell's is 15.7. Denny Hamlin's is 15, so same as Truex. And Kyle Busch is 23rd. So not been ideal for Kyle Busch, but I don't think he can count him out. We know he's a good road course racer. Just hasn't worked out
like this year. He's wrecked quite a few times this year on road courses.
He's had some spin outs. He's had some wrecks, which I think has hurt his speed. I think he probably would be faster without those issues. Absolutely. But he hasn't had a major issue, so I still count it in all the green flags. Like, he's finished on the lead lap in all of them. So there's hope here for these guys. And, you know, that's not even counting, like, I guess if you want to throw in Kurt Busch or Bubba Wallace or Daniil Kyvat in this analysis. That's just counting the JGR guys. So I'm showing value on Toyota win. And I may just take the strategy where I do Toyota to win one unit, Chase Elliott to win one unit, Kyle Larson and Ross Chastain, like, 0.6 units or something each. And then Allmendinger, what is it to get to 4.5 units win at 20-1? Like, 0.25 units or something. Quarter of a unit for at 20-1 is 5 units. So
yeah,
that's, let me really quick pull up my calculator since my brain isn't working. 1, 2, 3.2, like 3.5 units to win at least 4.5 units, right? So, and if any of the, even like the one unit bet wins or whatever, you get your unit back. So you end up profiting at minimum 2 units. Like, I don't hate that strategy. Of course, one of those has to win, any of the Toyotas or the 4 non-Toyota favorites that aren't worried about points. But yeah, I don't know. I mean, it's just something I was thinking about. And, you know, I do think if you reduce Tyler Reddick's odds, if you do reduce Daniel Suarez's odds, Briscoe, Cindric, Bowman, Kurt Busch's odds, maybe Kyle Larson or Ross Chastain or AJ Allmendinger or Chase Elliott, maybe they become value at their current odds. I don't know.
Certainly possible. I'm kind of trying to do the math in my head, you know, taking, because, like, you can get Truex at 16, Kyle Busch at 16, Hamlin at 20, Bell at 20. You know, if you, yeah, I'm just thinking. But yeah, so Chevy is minus 170 to win the actual race, looking at just manufacturers. And I think that makes sense. They've won the first three this season, first three road courses this season. And it really, you know, looking at COTA, Chevy was 4 of the top 5. At Sonoma, Chevy was number 1, and then it was Ford 2nd through 6th, and then Chevy, 7th through 9th. And then Chevy took the top 5 at Road America, all Chevys, and then 3 Fords. So it's going to be interesting to see, you know, whether these trends continue on these same guys ending up front. We talked about him last week. You know, I'm kind of looking at green flag speed over these three races. And Michael McDowell struggled in green flag speed at Circuit of the Americas, but still ended up finishing 13th. Sonoma, he went on. He was third in green flag speed and finished third. And then at Road America, eighth in green flag speed and finished eighth. And that's one thing. When you take a look at green flag speed this week, if the car, the best green flag speed cars finish up front, like it's, there's been no super craziness, which we saw last year at this Indy road course. Like this Indy road course race last year was the biggest joke of a race I've seen in a while, like with the turtles and all that shit. I've never been more frustrated watching a race. And then you had the, I think it was it Briscoe and Hamlin that got into it at the end, and then Briscoe got parked, and then it was AJ Allmendinger. Like, you know how I feel about AJ Allmendinger. It was AJ Allmendinger in victory lane. Like, that race was just so awful. I haven't heard, are they, like, do they have any plan for these turtles again? Like, or did they change anything from last year? You know, is this gonna, is there potential there for this to be a shit show once again? Do we have to take that into account with this betting and DFS and everything? I honestly haven't been paying attention.
I'm sure they learned their lesson, and B, the new car I think isn't gonna have as many issues with turtles, or whatever the hell they're called. Mm-hmm. So I think we're good there. I think we're good there. And had to open my beer. So I think we're good there. And you mentioned Michael McDowell, and this is another point I wanted to come to, because let's look at top Ford bets right now.
Mm-hmm.
And I haven't made any yet, but I may very well soon. Top Ford, and let's just look at the last two road course races, because I feel like there were some changes in the Ford running order in the past two road course races. Top Ford at Sonoma, Chris Buescher. Top Ford at Road America, Chris Buescher. Second Ford at Sonoma, Michael McDowell. Third Ford at Road America, Michael McDowell, the guy you were just talking about. Austin Cindric was second Ford at Road America. But fourth Ford at both of these, or I should say third Ford at Sonoma was Kevin Harvick, and fourth at Road America was Kevin Harvick. Fourth at Sonoma was Austin Cindric. So the top four were all the same, and then Blaney was fifth at both. So if we look at the top Ford market, and I'm just on DraftKings right now. I'm sure shopping around you may be able to find better odds. But if we look at the top Ford market, Cindric's the favorite, but he may be on this strategy, right, where he stays out. Blaney stayed out at Road America. He wanted that stage point. He may be good enough, far enough to the good, where he does it again and tries to grab a playoff point. Chase Briscoe may be on this suboptimal strategy. Harvick, Buescher, and McDowell are 7-1, 8-1, and 8-1, respectively, for top four.
You don't think Blaney's going to be purely on winning strategy?
I'm saying maybe he would. Right? Like, I don't know. But even then, even if he's purely on winning strategy, you could still bet him, Harvick, McDowell, and Buescher.
Mm-hmm. And he still only has five playoff points, which, you know, if he can get another, like, that's going to be somewhat valuable for him.
Yeah, exactly. So, it's tough to say. Now, if we factor in point standings, he has 13 playoff points. But still, you know, Chase Elliott has 40 then, if we factor in standings. So, he's still 27 behind his buddy Chase Elliott there. So it's tough to say what Blaney will do. He could be on one strategy or the other, but I think because there's the chance he could stay out, you got to discount it a little bit. But Austin Cindric should be discounted. Chase Briscoe should be discounted. They're the three favorites. But Harvick, McDowell, and Buescher are 7-1, 8-1, and 8-1 respectively on DraftKings. And again, if you shop around, maybe you can find better. And that just seems absurd to me that these guys are 4th, 5th, and 6th when they've been 1st, 2nd, and 3rd in the last two road course races, other than Austin Cindric sneaking in there in one of those as a third place. So I like betting Harvick and Dowell and Buescher 8-1 top, or 7-8 and 8-1 top Ford.
I just realized Harvick hasn't finished worse than 11th on a road course this year. He was 11th at COTA. He was 4th at Sonoma. And then he ended up 10th at Road America. And those are noteworthy because he has not qualified well this year. He was 18th at, started 18th at COTA, started 23rd at Sonoma when he finished 4th. And honestly, probably could have won that race with a little bit of, you know, things going the right way. And then when he finished... Yeah, when he finished 10th at Road America, he started back in 28th. So, you know, that he comes out with a good qualifying effort this weekend. He could very well easily contend for the win, I think, and definitely, you know, top forward. Speaking of qualifying, though.
And a Stuart Haas driver.
Exactly, exactly. You know, you see, you're reading my mind here.
Mm-hmm.
Cole Custer opens as 250-1. I think you messaged me and said, hey, Cole Custer's 250-1, and you kind of explained why that's a good bet. And I immediately went over to Indiana, and I'm like, I need this. Why is Cole Custer a good bet this week? I don't think – is he even still available at 100-1? I know –
he's still 100-1 at DK.
Okay. And they're really the only book that offers the poll winner, but – 250-1, like, you can never pass up when someone has a legitimate chance to win this. But even 100-1, I mean, is there still value at Cole Custer 100-1 qualifying to win the poll, and why?
So I wrote in my article that I would bet to 100-1, but I'd actually bet this even lower now that I look at it even further. So let's just start with what my article says. The first place to look is what has Cole Custer done this year at the road courses qualifying? 3rd, 6th, and 10th. Well, that's awesome. That's 19 divided by 3. You know, that's like 6.3 average. That's 6.3 average. But the worst of those, that 10th place starting position, the worst came at Road America, which is the least of the three road courses that is like Indianapolis, right? Road America is over 4 miles long. It has the oldest surface by a gazillion years, high tire wear. Whereas Indy is 2-point-something miles and has the newest surface. It's like right between COTA and Sonoma in terms of like speed and length, and actually newer surfaces than both of them. So like Road America is the least comparable, and that was when he qualified worst.
Mm-hmm.
At Indy, qualified third, or at the other two, he qualified 3rd and 6th. So the average of those two is 4.5. So let's say 4.5 is his ballpark number. Well, let's look at what he did last year. There were 7 road course races last year. Remember, 7. He did not qualify better than 10th at any of them. You're like, well, that's terrible. But obviously, this is a new car and everything's different. But the one he qualified the best at was 10th place at Indy. So if he's averaging 4.5, and this was his best last year, and what if it's his best this year? Well, his best was 3rd this year. So second or first is better than third, right? So there's just so much here pointing to a potentially, and I'm not, obviously not guaranteed, but a potentially good qualifying effort. So that's why I was like 250-1 is way too long. Bet it down to 100-1. But I dug in a little bit further after I got, because I was rushing to get that article out. Dug in a little bit further. You know how AJ Allmendinger is really good at road courses. What other track is he really good at?
Martinsville.
Yeah. Guess where Cole Custer qualified at Martinsville?
Where?
3rd. Remember he was running up front that whole race, basically?
Yeah.
Well, there's another track that I wouldn't say is super like Martinsville, but the same length, let's say. Bristol Dirt. He won the pole. Now, obviously, there's some heat racing stuff there, but still, like, there's some enough similarity here that I might bet this down to like 50-1 and feel good about it, right? Because if we look at DraftKings right now, the poll odds, Joey Logano's 40-1. The next longest after him is Cole Custer at 100-1. So why shouldn't Custer be like 50-1 if Logano's 40-1? I think Cole Custer should be like 50-1. Maybe even shorter, honestly. So I don't hate betting him at 100-1. If you didn't get him at 250-1, because I sure as hell blew that up right away when the article published and Action Network retweeted it and you retweeted it. And I posted it in the Action Network Slack chat that our employees have. We have like a little groupers section for like wild and crazy bets. That thing moved to 101 within 14 minutes of the article publishing. But I still think 101 is value.
I absolutely agree with you. I'm glad I got in at 250. But yeah, like, and that's like, I don't bet many poll winner bets because I'm never super confident on them. But I did hit Larson at Sonoma because he won the poll like, what, 5 years in a row or something. I'm like, he's going to do it again. But yeah, like, I keep saying it this year with road courses. Like, we know who's fast. So you go through, it's not that hard. Go through and look at who has qualified well at the road courses this year. And there's clear names that are up front every single time. Tyler Reddick and Cole Custer stick out. So Tyler Reddick's at 10-1. I don't see much value there at 10-1. You can still bet it if you want. But Cole Custer at 251, just it's one of those that just makes absolutely no sense. And I'm personally not expecting him to win the poll, but it's going to be a fun sweat because I think he makes the final round.
I'm expecting to finish second, right?
Yeah, of course. If that would, like, that would be fun.
Why? Well,
not at all. Not
and,
at all. But
you know, I think at one point DraftKings offered like a make final round or something. I thought I had seen that at least once this year. I wish they had done that for Cole Custer because I would have just blown that one up.
Yeah, Reddick's at 9, but yeah. Another guy and another Ford that kind of catches my eye looking at odds is Chase Briscoe at 15. Qualified second at Road America. He qualified 15th at Sonoma, and then at COTA he qualified 14th. But he, you know, looking back at Indy Road Course last year, it was Chase Briscoe starting second to William Byron on the pole. And, you know, William Byron's one of those guys. It, like, he, when I first look at pole odds, I was like, William Byron at 18-1 makes no sense at all because I know how he can qualify. Hendrick Cars have been good in qualifying this year at road courses. I'm like, what the hell's going on? Then I looked into it a little bit further. William Byron started, sort by number here. 24th at COTA, 20th at Sonoma, and 29th at Road America, which, you know, I think that's just a new car with Byron. Like, he was really good at qualifying in the old car. He's not good at qualifying on road courses in this car. So 18-1 did pop on me, but Briscoe at 15-1, you have any interest there? As far as pole odds?
I think I do. I mean, we know what kind of a road course racer he is. He's damn good. And if you look at him, like you
another
said.
Another Stuart Haas car, too.
Yeah, exactly. Another Stuart Haas car. And they've been pretty damn good at the road courses. So, you know, just like he's really good at road courses. He almost won this race last year. And I did want to say, as far as that, you know, we were talking about, like, would Denny Hamlin get parked for dumping Ross Chastain intentionally? Briscoe got parked, but it wasn't because he dumped Denny Hamlin intentionally. It's because he, like, cut through the infield and then didn't serve his penalty or some shit, you know? I think he had to serve, like, a lap penalty or whatever it was. But, yeah, he started this year second, 14th, and 15th. At the road courses, but last year he started second in Indy. So the best of the seven again last year for another Stuart Haas driver. So yeah, I think Briscoe 15-1 makes sense. But I definitely like that. And
going back to your Martinsville, looking into Stuart Haas Racing, three of the top six qualifiers at Martinsville.
Yeah.
Had Almirola second, Cole Custer third, Chris Buescher started fourth, another Ford, and then Kevin Harvick started sixth.
Yeah. So, you know, I haven't done, you know, I do correlations a lot, and we talked about this last week. I do correlations a lot with tracks and stuff for driver rating, average running position, average green flag speed, yada, 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 all these predictive metrics. I haven't done correlations for starting position. Maybe I should start doing that or something, because I would wonder if Martinsville qualifying would correlate well with Indy. Because I feel like it,
you know,
it might.
You know who was on the pole for Martinsville?
Wasn't it like Byron?
Nope.
No, it was – who was it?
Chase Elliott.
Yeah.
Yep. Who? 3-1 to win the pole for Indy Road Course. I don't – like, if I'm making any – if I'm making any outright bet – I just don't see how I can go against.
Can I take the Chase no? Right, can I take the no on 3-1 to win the poll though?
You'd take that
to win the poll?
Because I'm thinking about taking that for the poll.
No, I'd take the no on that. It's one taking lap,
some long
it's,
shots, and then
it's one lap. Chase if Elliott. He misses one corner, it's over, right? And if one driver puts together the perfect lap, I don't know. I'd take the no on that, but that's me. Let's look at Chase Elliott.
I'm looking at Chase Elliott starting second at Sonoma and winning the pole at Road America.
Damn, you have a good point. And winning the pole at Martinsville.
Yeah.
Damn. What did he do last year at Indy? Bad. See, now I want to know what he did last year at Indy. Third starting position.
Yeah.
But kind of like it. But that was the third best of his qualifying efforts last year out of 7 road course races.
Which is just insane. But I feel like that team struggled a little bit out of the gate with this new car on road courses. And now, like, I'm fully expecting Chase Elliott to win this race this week.
Mm.
I how can you go against this guy right now? No, his last five races, first, second, first, second, first. Just absolutely insane.
Sorry, you betting
which, by the way,
4.5-1 win?
I think I might.
Especially if you're removing a lot of these guys.
Should I put the Jordan Jinx on him? I'm going to bet him for the pole and the win. Can I parlay those? Oh, if DraftKings lets me parlay those.
Who'd you bet to win last week as the Jordan Jinx?
Jordan Jinx went to Truex last week.
I was not on Truex. Not because I thought it was a bad bet. I just wasn't on him.
But I did on this podcast say Chase Elliott was going to win, though.
That's true.
So I backed into a win.
Yeah, you backed into a win. Who did I say?
Even though Chase did not lead a single lap at Pocono. You tweeted this.
That was funny. I said Kyle Busch, and you know, I would have finished second and you would have finished third.
We should start keeping a tally of how like our picks do.
Yeah. I'm just glad I didn't get Eric Almirola for random fantasy this week.
Right. Who is your driver? I forget.
I think it's like the 31, maybe, if I remember correctly.
Haley?
Yeah, I think that's Justin Haley. I don't exactly remember who, but I always Google random fantasy. Not Google, but in the Twitter search, RotoDoc.
I don't know why I landed on this.
No, it's Daniel Suarez.
Is it?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. That's going to be interesting because he's been really good at road courses this year. I'm on your tweet from the other day about your first concert, last concert, best concert, and all of them are don't remember, fuck if I know, and then seeing the most Dave Matthews.
And band, that's because, by the way, I grew up in Charlottesville, Virginia, and Dave Matthews is from Charlottesville, so that's why I've seen him the most.
I'm gonna die on this hill. Dave Matthews Band sucks. It is just incessant moaning the entire time. I hate Dave Matthews Band.
Like I said, I've seen him the most because I'm from there. My friends like him. I served him coffee. He knows me by name. We're on a first name basis. You know, because I was a barista in Charlottesville for 7 years, and he would come into our coffee shop every day when he wasn't, you know, on the road or living in Seattle. He split his time between Seattle and Charlottesville. He would come in every day. He said, "Hey, Nick, Merry Christmas!" Like. First name basis with Dave Matthews. First name basis with Kyle Kirkwood. Like, I'm in with the big wigs. No, I'm just kidding. But yeah, no, like, I'm not a concert guy. I couldn't tell you what my first concert was. I couldn't tell you what my most recent concert was. I don't really have a favorite. Like, I'm not a concert guy. I don't know what the loudest was. I don't keep tally of this. I just know I've seen Dave Matthews the most because I'm fucking tired of seeing Dave Matthews. Exactly. And the next concert,
my thoughts exactly after I saw him once.
Yeah, exactly. So next concert, fuck if I know. I don't know. Oh, I will. Yeah, I've also played. So when I was in high school, I played in the UVA jazz band. Even though I was in high school, and I shouldn't say I played with Dave Matthews, but he knew the jazz instructor at Virginia. And he came in one day as a guest, so that was kind of cool.
I think it's pretty cool. I mean, even though he sucks, but another reason I'm talking myself more into Chase Elliott to win the poll this week
because he hates Dave Matthews. No, I don't know.
I hope so. But he hasn't started worse than fourth since Gateway.
Wow,
like that team is just so on it. He has one, two, three poles this year. Four if you count the qualifying race of Bristol Dirt. I don't remember how that was determined. But I'm talking myself into Chase Elliott, like 3-1 Chase Elliott pole win.
Yeah, Gateway's a long time ago. That's six races now that he's qualified inside the top four, right?
Right.
Yeah.
And now, like, road course,
mm-hmm.
Chase Elliott.
Mm-hmm.
The team is just
all know Cole Custer's going to win the poll.
Oh, I hope so.
That'd be the greatest thing ever.
I'd love for Cole Custer to win the poll and then Chase Elliott to start second. But
last time I made a 250-1 bet, my driver had a chance to win the race and crashed in the last lap.
Yeah, I can't complain about Atlanta. I did really
no. I mean, obviously with those top 10 bets. It was really good. But by the way, shout out to Greg Mathurin. Like I said, I played in the UVA Jazz Ensemble when I was in high school. They didn't have enough trombonists, so they poached me from high school, and I played with them. But I played trombone, and Greg Mathurin and I, who is one of the verified experts at the Action app, we played.
He's fucking trombone. Killing it this
he
year.
Is. He's crushing it.
I was on his profile.
Oh, he's.
I was just checking it out. Oh my god.
Yeah, yeah, he's killing it. And he was on that Christopher Bell win at New Hampshire. Like, I was on Bell Top Toyota, but he was on Christopher Bell to win.
Yeah, he's absolutely killing it this year.
Yes, absolutely. But
and he's getting the recognition too. He's got quite a few followers on there.
Oh yeah. Oh, yeah. And he deserves it. And I think he places, like, system bets on everything else, and it seems to be working out, like Major League Baseball, NBA.
I think he's up, like, significant units in every sport except, like, maybe tennis or something stupid.
Greg's not betting tennis. But, no, so Greg and I, we go all the way back to high school, and we were trombonists together in the high school band. So that's actually how I've known Greg for so long. But yeah, I just thought that was funny. He can vouch for my trombone playing there. Yeah, so shout out to Greg. He's slaying it. If you're not following Greg Mathurin, make sure you do. It is G Mathurin, MATHERNE 84 on Twitter. And it's Greg Mathurin 84 in the Action app.
Shout out Randy Moss, number 84.
I was born in 83, so, you know, I'm on the number 83 there.
You're old.
Oh, I'm pushing 39 here, saying.
Basically 40. But let's see here. We briefly talked about this. Who's this guy that's racing for Team Hesiberg? Former Formula One driver Daniil Kyvat, just because I know, like, just like when Joey Hand is in the car and all this other shit, people go crazy over these long shot underdogs. I've come around on Joey Hand.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I've always been completely against these quote unquote ringers. he's actually really freaking good for what, like, what he's able to, his car is junk, and he was, I feel like he was legitimately running, like, top 20. I mean, he qualified ninth at Road America.
He's been running inside the top 15 and even potentially in the top 10 at times.
Yeah. Yeah. But this Kyvat guy, like, the team Hesberg cars are, like we said, so bad, but he is running a Toyota. Like, is that going to make a difference? And we're not going to know, I don't think, till practice. And even then, we probably still won't know. But
so here's my thoughts on Danny. So Daniel, it's Daniel. Like,
is it?
Yeah, Daniel. But I just call him. Most people call him Danny. Like,
okay,
Danny. So Danny, and I think the last name is like Kvyat, like a Fiat that you're driving, and it's just like Kvyat. Danny Kvyat. But
I've butchered that name. Okay,
you're fine. I don't even know if I'm close to getting it right. But he's a Russian driver, raced in Formula One. Not exceptionally amazing. Not exceptionally bad. Just, you know, he raced for a mediocre team and put up mediocre results for a mediocre team. But look who else has raced for Team Hesberg. Former Formula One world champion Jacques Villeneuve, Loris Hesberg. Like, they have not put up any results at all in the Hesberg cars. Now, yes, that was in the Ford, and Loris Hesberg is racing in the Ford this weekend. But the Toyota, I believe, is a partnership with Josh Rome of Rome. I can't even say his name right. Rome Brothers Racing. I actually probably am butchering Josh Rome more than I'm butchering Danny Kvyat. But, you know, so I think they currently, in 2022, have been running a Toyota in the Camping World Truck Series. So, and in 2021, they ran a Toyota at the last portion of the year. And well, I should say most of the year, they ran Toyota. They did run a Chevy for two races. So I believe the reason they're running a Toyota is because they're partnering with Josh Rome. And he's also the crew chief, so that's why I think that's the partnership. But I don't think they're getting, like, JGR support or any shit like that. Like, it's just Team Hesberg and Rome Brothers Racing, whatever, you know, crew members collaborating on a Toyota instead of a Ford. And look at what Rome Brothers Racing has done in the trucks in the past 2 years in the Toyota. 33rd, 25th, 40th, 34th. 28th, 30th, 31st, and 31st. And again, this is in trucks where, at least in 2022, we only have 36 max per race. And they had a DNQ in a Chevy last year and a 28th in the Chevy last year. Like, this team in trucks ain't good. Let's go to Team Hesberg. I'm literally just Googling Team Hesberg Wiki. 22nd in the Daytona 500 because everybody and their brother crashed out.
Yep.
34th at COTA, 37th at Road America with Loris Hesemans. And the 22nd was Jacques Villeneuve, at a drafting race and finished probably, a gazillion laps down? I need to look at this up. 22nd, finished three laps down in Team Hesberg powered by Rome Brothers Racing. Ford. I expect nothing from them. Even with Danny Kvyat, even if he's a podium winning driver in Formula One, I don't think you can bet him. Like, yeah, okay, I bet Ty Gibbs last week. Give me my shit. I deserve it. Whatever. I don't think it was the worst bet I've ever made. I'm not touching Danny Kvyat. At least Ty Gibbs has raced stock cars, right?
Yeah, it's what I'm really hoping from this is he puts up a fast lap in practice and then qualifies high 20s or 30s and then just gets like 10-15% ownership DFS. That would be my perfect scenario.
That would be funny.
Cuz we saw it I think it was Joey Hand the first time he showed up. Like, everybody was on him. I'm just like, no. Like, Yeah, that's my perfect. But yeah, looking up team Hesberg, two DNFs for Heseman, or however the hell you pronounce that, and then yeah, like Jacques Villeneuve, 22nd at Daytona, which is probably still two laps off the pace,
three laps off,
if not more. Yeah, three laps off the pace. So,
yep. Sorry, I'm not factoring him. Jim ran this model. He said he's got Danny Kvyat 38th out of 38. I have Danny Kvyat 38th out of 38 as well, now that I've run my model. And the reason is because he gets more of a penalty than Loris Hesberg gets, because I have a rookie penalty which declines with number of races that you race in a stock car, which is a significant predictor of rookie performance. So I have no other way to judge Danny Kvyat as, a prior in NASCAR. Like in other rookies like Ty Gibbs, you can use their Xfinity or their trucks or things like that. There's not enough data for a driver to be like, the only other data we have them on is Formula One. Like, I'm not sitting there scraping Formula One data for Juan Montoya or, like the few drivers that have gone from Formula One to NASCAR. It's not worth it. So my prior for Danny Kvyat is Team Hesberg's equipment prior right now, plus his rookie penalty, which is more of a penalty than Loris Hesberg is getting right now, because Loris Hesberg is at least racing race number three.
Mm-hmm.
And that's about it. So he's dead last in my model.
Yeah. And to be fair, like, their goal has to be just him going out there and completing laps.
Yeah, I think so.
If he goes out there and completes all the laps, they'll consider that a win. And I have no interest in betting that or taking him in DFS.
No, and I keep calling him Loris Hesberg. He's Loris Hesemans, but it's Team Hesberg.
I was
confusing.
I was going to correct you, but I was like, fuck it, I don't care enough.
Yeah, I'm on beer like four or something, so whatever.
But so any we know who the fast cars should be. We know who the favorites are. Any long shot that's piquing your interest? We saw Alex Bowman challenge for the win at Circuit of the Americas. That kind of came out of nowhere. Obviously, we've had surprises this year. Like, coming into the season, we didn't expect Ross Chastain to do very well on road courses. We definitely didn't expect Daniel Suarez to do very well at road courses. But now that we have three road courses under our belt, what are the chances of a long shot? And I'll kind of specify long shot here. I'm talking guys mid-tier like Eric Jones, who finished ninth at Circuit of the Americas, maybe a Justin Haley, who's a decent road course racer, seems to always finish between, in those teens, can be relied on for that. Is there any chance that a long shot actually competes here? Like we saw at Sonoma, where, Michael McDowell, Chris Buescher, they could have won that race. Like, those are legitimate long shots. Chris Buescher, Michael McDowell running second and third in that race, having the best. Buescher had the best green flag speed. McDowell had the third best green flag speed in that race. Didn't really see that, at least in the top five for Road America, the most recent road course race. But Buescher was still sixth in green flag speed there at Road America. McDowell, like I said earlier, was eighth. And then, you can always have, like, I'm not going to consider A.J. Allmendinger a long shot. I think he's priced right at 20-1. Like, books have accepted that he's not really an elite, like, for a Cup Series. Like, he's not a guy to beat. He's just a guy, if he's in the right place at the right time, at the end of the race, he can get there. But you look at guys like Michael McDowell is 30-1. What the fuck? Like, there's no – okay, never mind.
McDowell's been better than A.J. Allmendinger the last two road course races. Obviously not at COTA, the last two. Chris Buescher has been better than A.J. Allmendinger last two road course races. The only reason I may not bet them is because I think I like them as top forward, right? Like,
mm-hmm.
I really like Harvick, Buescher, and McDowell as top forward. If you want to dig deep, I don't know. I mean, maybe Cole Custer. He's shown some road course prowess. I hate saying it. Maybe, but especially if you eliminate some of those other guys, but I don't know. It would take a crazy set of circumstances. I mean, he ran really well at COTA, and he ran pretty well at Road America, and we've seen him do well in Xfinity and trucks at road courses. I mean, there's the infamous Cole Custer versus John Hunter Nemechek spearing incident after they wrecked coming across the start-finish line at one of these road course races. Cole Custer just straight up just spears JHN. Oh my God. Yeah. If you haven't seen that, you got to watch that. It was amazing. But, so like, he's not a terrible road course racer. I don't know. I think Cole Custer's a pretty good one actually, but,
he just qualifies too high for DFS. Like he can't play
for DFS. Yes. I'm sorry. Yeah. But high. if for winning, like if you eliminate a lot of these guys, I shouldn't say eliminate, but like you reduce their odds on all the guys we've talked about. I don't hate maybe 125-1 on Cole Custer, which you can get at points bet per this time of recording. I don't hate it. I don't know if I love it. I think I'd prefer 250-1 to win the poll, and that's my Custer play. But yeah, I'm not really feeling the mid tier, the long tier. I mean, if I did, I'd say Busher or McDowell, maybe Harvick, but I'd rather just bet them top forward.
Yeah, I can't bet. Like 30 is way too short for me on those guys, especially when you have like a Logano there sitting at 40. Kurt Busch sitting there at 50. Corey LaJoy is 2,500-1. And I understand he's not going. 2,500-1 is insane though. Why can't we get that on fucking super speedways? I've never seen 2,500-1 before. I can say
Cody Ware's 5,000-1.
I think is Harrison Burton, is he 10,000-1?
No, he's just 1,000-1.
1,000. Yeah, I'm missing the. Oh my God, Josh Williams in the 78 for 5,000-1, for yeah. BJ McLeod. Yeah, 5,000-1. That car is absolute garbage. But yeah, I don't think I've ever seen those long odds. Yeah, give me that for.
We might get a 10,000 at like Circa or something. Actually, I should probably see if they've opened up odds. Usually, lately they've been Wednesday. I know when we recorded Stacking Dennys a lot last year, they had just made odds like as we were live or just before we went live. And apparently my Circa app is not connecting. Oh, there we go. Let's check. I don't think they have odds, but you never know. Auto racing. Yeah, just F1. So, I don't know if we see a 10,000-1, it could be Cody Ware here or Josh Williams here, but I don't think I've ever seen a 10,000-1. I've certainly seen 5,000-1 before. I mean, it's always these same guys, but I mean, Bubba Wallace, 101 top Toyota. What do you think of that?
We didn't talk about that. I feel like at this point, if you're giving me 100-1 or longer, I'm betting it. I'm throwing a few bucks on it. I can't not, because it's way too long. And we saw the Indy road course race last year. Bubba was the top Toyota. Like, mm-hmm. 100-1, like, I will always bet something like that. For top Toyota, there's six Toyotas?
Seven this week with Danny Kvyat.
Seven. But I don't care how awful Bubba Wallace is at road courses. I don't care if he's DNF'd at every single one this year. 100-1 for something that all it takes is a shit show that we've seen last year and could potentially see again.
And Road America. I'm going to bet it. Remember, like, didn't Denny Hamlin get a penalty and Kyle Busch had something happen? Like, Bubba was running, like, second or third Toyota at one point. And, of course, people on Twitter are giving a shit for betting him 150-1 as top Toyota. But he legitimately was sitting there, like, third. Like, I think it was, like, Bell. Like, Kurt Busch was terrible. He was, like, Bell, Truex, and Bubba at one point. Because I think Denny got a penalty, and Kyle Busch had all sorts of problems. We got shit for him at 151, and the guy, of course, after the race, like, see, you lost 150-1 bet. I'm like, yeah, well, I'm supposed to lose that 149 times out of 150, but actually not really, because I only think I'm going to lose that like 1 out of 50 or something, right? Like, it's so dumb when people give you shit on Twitter for losing a 150-to-1 bet. Like, go fuck yourself. Go fuck yourself. I don't care. If you're going to give me shit for losing a 151 bet on Twitter, you need to get a life. You need to get a life. If that's,
it's not like we're putting $100,000 on this.
We're putting $10 on it and hoping we hit.
Yeah.
You know?
15, if you can't afford to lose $10, then don't bet.
Yeah, we're putting a tenth of a unit. Maybe 2/10 of a unit. Like that kind of. I put 2/10 of a unit on Cole Custer, 250-to-1. Because it's that, you know. The larger the edge, the more you should bet per Kelly Criterion. But my point is, yeah, Bubba Wallace 100-to-1, that's fine.
Not to mention, look at how Bubba's running lately. Mm-hmm. Eighth at Pocono, third at New Hampshire, 14th at Atlanta. He had break issues at Road America. He finished 35th, 12th at Nashville.
He was good in practice at Sonoma, and he was fine enough at Road America in the race. Like
Sonoma, he had an engine issue.
Yeah. But in practice, he looked really good, is what I'm saying. Like, remember, like, we were like, oh, God, the Toyotas look really good in practice. And this was the second road course race of the year at that point. So people were on Toyotas, and all of a sudden they shit the bed. It was like, wow, that's bad. So avoided them completely for Road America. But Bubba could surprise us. He's like Austin Dillon was terrible at road courses. Austin Dillon is getting better. Bubba Wallace is getting better at road courses. He's not Austin Dillon level right now, where Austin Dillon is 10th to 15th every road course. But Bubba could finish there in the right circumstances, 10th to 15th. And if, you know, enough, like if Kurt Busch does the point strategy and problems happen with Denny Hamlin and Kyle Busch and, you know, crash at the end with multiple cars and several restarts, 100-to-1, Bubba Wallace? Yeah, I'm fine with that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and, like, as far as, like, it just takes the right circumstances of those things to happen. But one thing is Bubba Wallace has been qualifying well. I feel like that team, ever since they made the pit crew changes, has just been a little bit different. And you know what? Like you said, 100-to-1, I'm not worried about. I'm way more confident in the rest of my betting over the rest of the course of the year for me to be able to afford this and not worry about it. You know, 100-to-1, at the end of the day, it's fun. Because I sit there and I'm like, I'm actually rooting for something that could happen. And, yeah. But, yeah, anytime you're making these long shot bets, like if you're expecting to win these long shot bets, you're not – please stop betting because – chances are you're going to lose your house or something. Right. Because
yeah, and we're not sitting here expecting to win Cole Custer. We're not sitting here, you know, expecting to win Matt DiBenedetto 300-to-1 or Corey LaJoie 250, 750, whatever it is to one. We're not expecting to win those. But we're expecting if we make that bet 250 times, we'll hit at least one out of those 250. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And how many 300-to-1 bets have I made betting NASCAR? Probably 15 to 20 maybe. And I've come close twice. It's pretty good. It's pretty fucking good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And it, like I said, it gives you something to root for. It's fun.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, I have no problem, and I'll say it again, I have no problem betting Kyle Kirkwood every week 100-to-1. Even if he finishes 20th or wrecks out or slow, because there's been enough times where he's put himself in circumstances to potentially get the win that if things break just right, he will get that win. And the data backs it up because if you look at his performance, if you look at comparable drivers to him in that same equipment performance, they win like 1 out of 50. So why is 100-to-1 bad value? It's not. People just don't understand. Oh, you're betting him 151. He's never going to win. It's probably if let's be real. If somebody's hating on a 150-to-1 Bubba bet, they probably have some other issues with Bubba.
Yeah, won't go there. But I'm a member of enough Facebook groups of NASCAR that it's just pathetic.
Yep.
That's all I'm going to say on that.
Yeah. I really hope he wins some more races. And I think he will. Based off how he's been performing, I think he will. It's just a matter of time.
Mm. Yeah, like, when you're still getting hate, when Bubba's still getting hate for finishing third at New Hampshire and legitimately running top five for most of the day, yeah, there's
an agenda there.
That's not, yes, exactly.
It's the same agenda that people had against Danica Patrick, maybe for different reasons. But, like, if Danica had a good race, they had an agenda against her because she's a woman, right? Like, it's just people will find agendas for one reason or the other. And it sucks because even if you don't like last year Denny Hamlin, now you love him. But like, if you don't like a driver, you can admit if they had a good race, if they drove really well, if they're talented.
And I always did that with Denny. Like me personally, like I hated Denny Hamlin up until like 2 months ago. But I always said he is the best super speedway racer in the series, and it's not close.
Yes.
Like you have to give credit where credit's due. And honestly, Bubba's right there. Speaking of super speedways, like Bubba Wallace is right there with Denny Hamlin.
We see that now and his odds are 12-1, 14-1.
Exactly. Exactly.
And, yeah. and here's the thing. You'll be a better bettor if you take those biases out. If you evaluate things as they truly are, you will make more money instead of, "Whoa, Bubba sucks. Oh, Bubba's whatever. Like, oh, Danica sucks. Oh, Eric Almirola's DNF'd 5 out of the last 8 races." And it works both ways. He's DNF'd 5 out of the last races. He's dead to me. Or he's DNF'd 5 out of the last 8 races. He's due. No, both of those are wrong. It's all just probability. Yeah. It's all just probability. Little spurts happen. Got to look at the longer picture, the data overall, right? Like I tweeted this multiple times this year about Eric Almirola. He hasn't DNF'd in fucking forever. I mean, it was early last year was the last time he DNF'd, which means, it's been quite a long time. I'm actually Googling it, Wikipedia-ing it right now. But Eric Almirola's last DNF, now he's had some bad races since his last DNF, but his last DNF was Dover of last year. So now we're at 37, 38, 39, 40, 41, 42, 43, 44, 45. 45 races without a DNF for Eric Almirola. And he could not DNF last year at the start of the season. He had 5 DNFs in the first 13 races. And people are saying he's due, or people saying all he does is DNF, right? And even after 13 races, the next 3 races, he finished 22nd or worse. Like, he had problems the whole first half of last year. You know how many times, right? So the NASCAR season is 36 races long. Last year, he had, in the first 16 races, he had problems in 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 of the first 16 races. He had problems in 4 of the final 20 races. 10 of the first 16, and then 4 of the final 20. And you know what? That just kind of averages out. And it maybe is a little high for that year, but you average it with the year before, the year now, a couple years. Like, it all averages out over the long run. And you need larger sample sizes. Yeah, it's hard to do. It's NASCAR. It's hard to have large sample sizes. But you still need to understand that a 3-race or a 5-race shit streak, right? Like, look at Kyle Busch. We were talking about he hadn't been performing well, or Alex Bowman, or whoever, right? Like, they'd been on these cold streaks. Like, I was listening to SiriusXM NASCAR radio last week, and Dave Moody, "Why is Kyle Busch the favorite at 6-1? He hasn't finished inside the top 12 in the last 5 races." Well, because he's fucking good at Pocono, and you're looking at a 5-race sample size. Like, Kyle Busch should have potentially won Pocono, at least absolutely was the best car. Should have finished 2nd. And you're like questioning why he was the favorite to win Pocono? It doesn't make sense. All because of a 5-rig sample size.
Just for the record, Dave Moody's a fucking idiot, so that's why.
I I won't go that far because I actually enjoyed listening to his radio show. I know.
I can't stand him.
I know there's, yes, I understand. And I understand why you can't stand him. But I think he handles really dumb callers really well. And he's not a NASCAR shill. He will say when there's problems. Obviously, I do think he biases towards NASCAR. But I listen to SiriusXM NASCAR radio a lot. And, I mean, how else are you going to get your 24/7 NASCAR news? So, you know, at that point, you kind of have to put up with certain radio personalities you may or may not like, but at least you're hearing about NASCAR. I fucking love NASCAR. So I'd rather listen to a radio personality I hate than not listen about NASCAR than not listen about NASCAR at all. Right. So that's kind of my stance on that. And I I have no problem criticizing Dave Moody. I have no problem giving him kudos where I think it's due. My point is, and I've noticed this on SiriusXM NASCAR radio this year especially, they've gotten more into betting. Yeah, they've had like the Fantasy NASCAR preview show with Pete Pistone and Brennan Gaughan, et cetera, et cetera. And they've done very well. They're good at it. I've called in to that show before. They've invited me as a guest on the SiriusXM NASCAR radio show. Love it. That's great. But now I notice like the whole station is getting more into the betting side of it. And that's good because we want more people getting into the betting side because it brings more engagement to the sport. But to sit here and question why Kyle Busch should be the 6-1 favorite at Pocono or 7-1 favorite or whatever it was because he's had a 5-race bad streak is very short-sighted. And that's what I'm going to say about that.
And that's the analysis we don't need.
Right. Like, right.
Anybody with a brain or a decent ability to look at not only like the last 6 races have been a very interesting streak to say the least on just overall races. You got 2 road courses in there. You got Atlanta, which was a shit show, or could have been a shit show. Nashville, which second race ever, which by the way, Kyle Busch led 54 laps and that was just a stupid pick call at the end. That's why he didn't finish well. And then, you know, New Hampshire in there as well. I feel like it's just lazy looking up, and I'm going to preface this by saying I think it's lazy looking up, but at the same time I'm about to do the same thing because I was just I was just pulling up. I'm going over the last 15 races, so I feel like this is a bigger sample size. Yes. And I am kind of shocked. Again, there's certain races in here that certain track types that are affecting this. But average finish wise, over the last 15 races, there's a guy that beats Daniel Suarez, beats Alex Bowman, Joey Logano, Austin Cindric, William Byron, Denny Hamlin, Kurt Busch, Brad Keselowski, Chase Briscoe, Eric Almirola, Austin Dillon, Eric Jones.
It's got to be Michael McDowell, right?
Michael McDowell, the 9th best average finish over the last 15 races, 14.5. Kyle Busch is at 14.3.
Yep.
That is, he has more, McDowell has more top 20s than Kyle Busch over this span. That's, I'm hopping on the McDowell train.
Here's the funny thing.
I am.
You're using the last 15 races. If you use the last 13 races, it gets even better, right? If you cherry pick 13 instead of 15, you remove Richmond and Martinsville, where we finished 30th and 25th.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So, like, the last 13 like races, it's damn good. But, yeah, I mean, over the last 13 races, finished inside the top 10, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Yeah, more than half the time. Or last 13 races, and only 2 finishes outside of the top 18.
That's solid.
Now, the question is, had they been cheating all of the last 13 races?
That's, yes. So, because we've seen it happen before, like when Logano got popped for cheating.
2017, I think.
Yeah, like they were junk after they got popped for cheating. Is this the same thing McDowell? You know, the only reason that their car got inspected was because they finished so high. Certainly possible.
Yeah.
It's
tough to know because, like, we almost have to, like, keep data on which cars were the random R&D ones to know. Like, mm-hmm. if he was the random R&D after he finished third at Sonoma, that would lend credence, like, no, it's been true performance or seventh at Darlington or, what, you know, those kinds of things. But we just don't know. And I'm sure somebody has the data or we could go back and look it up, whatever. But that's not like that's things we don't think to keep track of until after the fact. And I haven't sure as hell haven't kept track of that.
And it's certain situations too. Like, you know,
yeah, I will say Buescher went through and came out clean. So feeling good about that Buescher top Ford bet. I haven't made it yet, but I feel like I probably should. He's been top Ford last two road course races, and he's still 8-1 top Ford. And we've got three Fords that may be on point strategies or stage win strategies. At least two, I would think. Maybe three, if you count Blaney.
15th at Martinsville. I keep looking at Martinsville, too.
I worry more about Martinsville with, like, qualifying than I do about the race itself. If you look at Martinsville, then you got to think Austin Dillon's just a fucking man this weekend.
Well, Martinsville, qualifying-wise, Buescher started fourth.
See? Yeah. There you go.
And, like, we know how important track position is at road courses.
Yeah. Maybe it's Chris Buescher week. I don't know.
Oh, man. Let me pull this up real quick. My DFS year for road courses has been pretty much the same each time. I think every single one of them so far, I've been crushing until like the last 10, five laps. And it's gone. Like, I'm pretty sure Coda just ruined, because I used to be like, road courses used to be my bread and butter.
Yeah.
They'd be my absolute best track type. I would crush every single time. Coda, I was having my best DFS day ever at Coda this year. With one lap to go.
Mm-hmm.
One fucking lap to go. And Kyle Busch went off course, and then the whole Allmendinger thing happened. And it put me at a loss. Like, I went from my best day ever to a loss.
Right.
And ever since then, I feel like I'm just jinxed.
The Jordan jinx.
Yes, because I lost money at Sonoma, and then I lost money at Road America.
And it's funny because I've done the opposite. I've traditionally not been the best at road courses. I've hit a few winners here and there. Like, I know I rode up 2 years ago a Chase Elliott 5.5-1 winner that won at one of the road courses in 2020. Maybe it was 2019. I don't remember. Two or three. But, like, generally speaking, I haven't been great at road courses, but this year I fucking slayed road courses. Obviously, I won Tyler Reddick Road America. I won Ross Chastain at Coda, and I live bet Daniel Suarez at Sonoma. So I'm 3-for-3 at road courses this year.
So you don't have any outright bets yet?
Not yet. Not a single. The only bet I've made is Cole Custer 250-1, and then the top or the Toyota to win 450 or 4.5-1.
All right. So as we do every week, who is your pick to win?
Fine. Chase Elliott.
Yep, same.
Yeah.
Like,
sucks. I hate it.
What I hate even more is I'm thinking about betting him 450.
I know. I've talked about it on the show, right? Like, if you bet the top four non-potential points drivers, it's Elliott, Larson, Chastain, and Dinger. Like, and then the others after that are Harvick, McDowell, and Buescher in whatever order. But I'm just going to bet them all maybe top four. Like, and then I bet Toyota. Like, I feel like I have a path to a big weekend or a big loss.
Mm-hmm.
You know? or I shouldn't say big wheel, like a small. I'm. It's like the opposite of what I usually do. I usually say lose small, win big. I feel like I'm going for win small, lose big this weekend potentially, and I probably shouldn't do that. So, I obviously don't make all the bets I've recommended. I'll figure out my fucking strategy here at some point. But I feel like I'm going opposite of like my normal strategy of like. Win big, lose small, win big. And I see this. I'll see somebody have like 8 bets on drivers to win. I'm like, you're set up to just lose big or win small.
Yeah,
I'm not trying to grind out small wins every week and then lose big. I'm trying to grind out small losses and win big.
Yeah.
And I've been that way with DFS. I'm that way with betting. That's just my mentality. Straight up, it's also just finding value. But I think some people are so afraid to have a losing week that they'll bet like 8 drivers or 6 drivers or
not
9
even,
drivers.
Not even a like not even a quote-unquote losing week, because if they still hit the winner but they even still lost money, they can still say, oh, I've hit the winner the last 17 races or whatever.
Right,
like,
right.
I don't care if you're down fucking 20 units over that same time period. Sorry. If you're down $2,000, I refuse to use units anymore.
Exactly.
But big question though. I think I've completely talked myself into Chase Elliott 3-1 for the pole. I don't think that this is going to happen. But could his odds get longer than 450? With a bad qualifying and practice effort, or even if he's slow in practice and qualify. Basically, what I'm asking here is, if you're going to bet Chase Elliott right now, do you need to bet it right now at 450? Because if he goes out there and he's the fastest in practice and he wins a pole, it's going to go down to 3. Like,
yeah, I think you're right. I think he's going to be fast. When was the last time? I mean, I think Coda was the perfect situation to fade Chase Elliott because it was a brand new car, potentially lost his advantage, whatever, yada, yada. Obviously, they've gained it all back in the last 2 road course races.
He just hasn't gotten the win. But
right.
Second, he had the best green flag speed at Road America, finished second. Could have easily won Sonoma. Mm-hmm. I feel like they had a...
Et cetera,
penalty,
yada, yada, whatever it was. Yeah. I don't remember. But... Yeah, I mean, Chase Elliott's easily, over the last 2 road courses, basically, if you average him, been the best. And it's not close. So, unless he just botches his qualifying lap and starts mid-pack, even then, only going to be 5.5, maybe.
Yeah.
Right?
They're not gonna take him anywhere, any longer than 6.
6.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
So like 450, and here's the thing. I'm clicking through right now. Let's say I discount, because my model is not taking into account strategies. How can I? Like, I don't know what driver's gonna do. What strategy am I? I would just be guessing input strategies. Maybe if we have enough years of data under this format with road courses late in the season or a certain point away from the right, you know, percentage of the way through the season, maybe I can figure out something where like there's a probability this driver will use this strategy, which will discount their winning odds, et cetera, et cetera. But we're not there yet. I can't do that. Nobody can do that. But let's say we discount Tyler Reddick. Let's say we discount just the 4. Kurt Busch, Tyler Reddick, Austin Cindric, and Chase Briscoe. We discount those 4. Chase Elliott is basically break even in my model at 4.5-1 to win.
Mm-hmm.
So there we are.
Yeah. I hate betting favorites so much.
I do too. I hate it. You know, we both rarely do it, but there's times to do it. I've bet Chase Elliott 5.5-1 at a road course before. Maybe this is a week to bet him 4.5-1. I don't know. I don't know. I don't want to talk myself into it. I need to think about it more.
Yeah, the longer we talk about it, the more I'm just gonna. Yeah,
it's honestly my favorite market. I think that I basically talked myself into this is just betting Harvick, McDowell, and Buescher.
The more you talk about that, the more I don't hate it. Yeah. I like it didn't pop at me at first, like the 8-1. I'm like, it's good odds. It's not great, but yeah,
the same top five have been the same top five as far as top forward. And yeah, none of them in Briscoe. Like, it's been Cindric, Blaney, not in this order: Cindric, Blaney, Harvick, McDowell, and Buescher. And actually, it's been Buescher, McDowell, Harvick, 1-2-3 in that order. Other than, like I said, Austin Cindric popping in there for one of those. And then Blaney in fifth. It's like,
yeah,
I don't know. Just one of those things I noticed. I think it's probably value on Harvick, McDowell, and Buescher at 7-8-1 range. And I think that's maybe where I'll go. And maybe I just won't bet outrights this week. Maybe I'll take Toyota to win, top forward, pole, call it a week unless I see something after practice. I don't know.
That's another thing. One final thing here with practice. The race is at 2:30. Practice is at 9:30 in the morning.
Mm-hmm.
Qualifying's at 10:30 in the morning. So
may not another be thing most to just representative of race time temperatures.
Exactly. Yeah. And I haven't even looked at the weather, but I'm sure it's going to rain. It seems like it always does.
Oh, more reason to bet Toyota 4.5-1 to win.
We haven't, like, by the way, I think Pocono, that was the first time ever that them moving up the race worked in their favor completely, because it started raining soon after that race.
I think Atlanta too, right? They got the whole race in. We were talking all day about how it wasn't going to work. They moved it up, and I think right after it rained in Atlanta.
Did it?
I think so.
I don't remember. I was very drunk for the Atlanta race.
Yeah, I was too, but I think they were calling for the evening stuff. I'm Googling Indianapolis weather forecast. Uh-oh. Sunday, chance of rain.
PM showers, 35%. Supposed to get down to 69. Nice.
Nice. Yeah, I see that too, 69. I wonder what the humidity would be. Maybe 69. 63. Yeah, we're close. Let's bump that humidity up a little bit. 69% chance of rain, 69% humidity, 69 temperature. It would be the nicest race ever.
Called the trifecta.
Actually, okay, I do have to give a shout out to Dale Tanhart, because I'm a math guy and I've never thought about this. None of that. I'm sure all of you have, but he posted on, you know, because of the tricky triangle, Pocono, the nicest triangle, 69 degrees, 69 degrees, and 42.0 degrees, and like, that actually adds up to 180 degrees, which is a triangle. I've never known that ever. What the fuck?
No way. No way.
How have I never noticed this as a math PhD?
Oh.
That was the nicest triangle ever. I will smoke to that one.
How did I miss that? How did I miss that?
That's insane. That's incredible. Clap. clap Dale Tanhart. Incredible. But yeah, it's true. 69 plus 69 plus 42. Is 180 degrees, and I cannot believe I've never known that in my whole math-brained life. Anyway, we're running long, so
yeah. Oh, we're over 2 hours.
Yeah, it's been we knew this was going to be a fun episode.
Oh yeah, oh yeah. So it is. So we're both on Chase Elliott this week. I don't see how you can be, you know, but. We'll see how this whole race plays out. He wasn't great here last year, but yeah, I cannot bet against that guy right now.
Yeah, he's still, I think, in the lead at a couple points, even off speed. It just wasn't like a dominant Chase Elliott.
Exactly, yeah. And plus, the whole race last year was just stupid.
Especially the very end. But I don't think we're going to have those issues this year.
No, I agree. I don't think we'll see that. So good luck to every bettor this weekend, every DFS player. And we'll talk to you next week when NASCAR heads to Michigan.
Good luck, everyone.
My favorite track.
No, mine neither. Really like it. But well, I guess we'll see with this car. But Auto Club is exciting. Of course, it's way more tire wear, but we'll see.
Yeah. So, yeah, good luck, you guys. And we'll talk to you next week. See ya.